my mom basically issued an ultimatum. She said, you can either go to church or you can live in my house. I was 17 years old. I felt like, God, is this what I get? I have chosen to follow you. And now I have no mom, no dad, and nowhere to go. I remember looking out and seeing my pastors, and their jaws were on the floor. My jaw was on the floor. Everyone was just so shocked and could not believe that this was happening. Hello everyone, welcome back to the second episode of 828 with Cait. I'm your host, Cait Taylor, and I am really excited today because I am sharing one of my all-time favorite stories with you. I think it's especially going to resonate with those of you who have unsaved family members or friends, or people in your life that you are currently praying for that they would come to know Jesus. Or maybe you are even the only Christian in your family or in your friend group. I know how that feels, and if that's you, I am praying that you will listen to this episode until the very end, because I think what I'm going to tell you should give you a lot of hope. In the last episode, I talked about my journey to becoming a Christian at 17, and in this episode, I'm going to tell you what happened after that. Because it was not all smooth sailing once I became a Christian. In fact, it was quite the opposite. I was kind of a first-generation believer in my family, so I know how hard it is when your loved ones haven't come to the truth yet, or when the people around you don't believe what you believe. When I first started going to church, I was living with my mom, and she was very anti-God, anti-church, did not want to hear about it at all. Back then, I didn't know or understand why she was so opposed to it. I did know that she was kind of dabbling in New Age stuff. Crystals, manifestation, mediums, fortune tellers, as had I before finding Jesus. But there was also just this hostility there that I sensed from her towards God. I'm sure if you've ever shared your faith with anyone, it's usually very apparent whether that person has an openness to receive the word or if they are highly resistant to it. Maybe they even roll their eyes at you, they say something rude, or they just act completely disinterested. In the Bible, Jesus says, "For the hearts of these people are hardened, and their ears cannot hear, and they have closed their eyes, so their eyes cannot see, and their hearts cannot understand, and they cannot turn to me and let me heal them." That's Matthew 13:15. Now, I didn't realize then that only God can change a hardened heart. If someone has closed their heart off from the truth, there is only so much you can do, because that seed you are attempting to sow is not falling onto fertile ground. So you have to pray that God would shift something in them, that God would soften them to the truth. I would pray Ezekiel 11:19 over them, where God says, "I will give them an undivided heart and put a new spirit in them. I will remove from them their heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh." I didn't know this at 17, that I probably needed to be more focused on prayer than on preaching in this situation. So in retrospect, I was a bit too pushy on my mom when she really wasn't in a place to receive it. But I just desperately wanted her to experience what I was experiencing. And I would almost argue that if you don't have an eagerness or a desire to tell people about Jesus, have you really truly experienced him? Because I once heard this analogy. Someone said, if you went to a restaurant and they had the best food you had ever tasted, you would want to tell your friends and family afterwards because you want them to have that same amazing experience. Or if you went to see a film and you left the cinema feeling so inspired, you would surely tell your friends and family, you have to go and see this film. It's incredible. It will change your life, right? Well, now imagine the thing you experienced actually did change your life, did help your depression, did give you more joy and more peace. That's exactly how it felt when I came to know Jesus. It was like I had met the best person I had ever come across in my whole life, and I wanted to introduce him to everyone I knew because he was healing me from the inside out. I was shifting from feeling suicidal to feeling joy, from complete hopelessness to finding real hope to hold on to. And I wasn't instantly healed of everything in my life. There are many things I still struggle with today. But for the first time, there was a light at the end of the tunnel. And after everything my family and I had been through with the abuse and the trauma, I thought, my mom needs this too. But despite me trying to show her how much I believed this could also change her life, it wasn't happening, and we would just get into arguments. And eventually, during an argument, my mom basically issued an ultimatum. She said, you can either go to church or you can live in my house. As soon as she said that, I knew what I needed to do. I knew I needed to leave, and there was no question in my mind, not even for a split second. It wasn't that I was happy to walk away from my family. I didn't want to leave. But for me, there was no other option. I was finally feeling like life was worth living, and I couldn't give up Jesus for anything or anyone, not even for my own family. And I think that's what Jesus meant when he said, if you want to be my disciple, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else. Your father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. He's obviously not saying that we should actually hate people. That would contradict everything Jesus teaches. But he is saying that every other relationship must be secondary. Matthew 10:37 says, anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And I have a note here from Dr. Tony Evans. It says, Jesus deserves priority over every relationship. If you must choose between Jesus and a family member, then Jesus wins. You must choose to obey Jesus rather than do what they want. This is the call to and cost of discipleship. And that goes for any relationship. If you are faced with a choice between this person or Jesus, you must choose Jesus every time. And I was willing to do that because Jesus had changed me and my entire life. But although the decision was clear, it definitely wasn't easy. I was 17 years old, having to leave my home, leave my family, my mom, my little brother. I didn't have anywhere to go. I had to try and find a new job because at the time I was waiting tables, I was super underpaid, I couldn't afford rent by myself. That was kind of a tough spot to be in at that age. And honestly, I felt frustrated with God. I felt like, God, is this what I get? I have chosen to follow you. And now I have no mom, no dad, because he already left when I was a kid, and nowhere to go. It felt like everything was being stripped away from me, and I didn't know why. But I packed up my stuff, and thankfully, at the time, I was dating a guy from my church, and his mom said that I could go and stay with her temporarily. So I stayed there for, I want to say, about a week. During that time, I posted on my church Facebook group, just explaining what had happened and seeing if anyone had a place I could stay. And my pastors ended up reaching out to me. They had several spare rooms that they would often rent out to people, and one was becoming available. So I was able to move in with them, and I had a beautiful big bedroom with an ensuite bathroom. I just felt so peaceful living there with people who believed what I believed, where I could be open about my faith. And one of my best friends was also renting another one of their bedrooms, so it was really fun for us to be able to live together for a while. I ended up staying there for about 4 months. I got a job as a makeup artist too, so I was making a little bit more money. But although it was peaceful knowing that I wasn't coming home to any arguments, what I did come home to sometimes was the pastors pulling me aside to say that they had received messages that day from my mom. My mom would be messaging them saying things like she thought that I was in a cult, that they had taken her daughter and I was now part of this cult. I think she thought that they were taking my money. All these crazy things, but I think she was just really upset and really angry and probably had a lot of preconceived ideas about what this church was. Now, throughout that time, I personally did not have very much communication with my mom because things were so tense. And what I did not know is that she was working with a lady named Julie. This will seem like a random side note, but just remember this fact because at the end, it's going to blow your mind. Julie is a Christian lady, and she would sometimes invite my mom to go to church with her. I did not know any of this, and I'm sure that Julie did not know what was going on at home or the fact that I had moved out because of going to church. And obviously, my mom would turn her down, but she liked Julie as a person and as a friend. And to me, this is evidence that although I couldn't be there actively ministering to my mom, he was still placing people in her path to try and reach her. Anyway, after about 4 months of separation, my mom and I finally kind of made peace around Christmas time. Things were still not great, but I was able to go home for the holidays. I think we probably made peace mostly for my little brother's sake. Mom was definitely still not on board with me going to church, but I think we had just established that we were not going to talk about it. And there was this one day after I had gone back to my mom's house that I remember so significantly. No one else was home that day. It was just me. I don't recall if Mom and I had an argument earlier that morning, but I was having a meltdown because I had been seeing all of these perfect families at my church. I was seeing my friends who had two parents still together. They all go to church together. They say grace before they eat. When I go to their house, they have scripture up on their walls. And I just felt really upset with God, because everyone else seemed to have this thing that I wanted so badly, to have a perfect family. And here I was with two parents who are both unbelievers. One I've never even met, my dad, and the relationship with my mom is now hanging by a thread. And at this house, we had a longish hallway with bookshelves up one side. And I remember just pacing up and down this hallway, pacing nonstop. I was so upset. I was bawling my eyes out. And I just said to God, why would you let me be born into this family? And all of a sudden, as I said that, I immediately stopped pacing. I stopped crying. I felt this calm feeling come over me. And I felt God speak back to me, because you are the best chance they have of knowing me. I know people will be doubtful about that, because I didn't audibly hear God's voice booming in my ear. But I think for anyone who has experienced God's voice in this way, you will know exactly what I mean. I was in such a state in that moment. I was hysterically crying. I couldn't even think straight. And what I said to God in that moment was just out of sheer frustration and anger. But what came back to me sounded like my own thoughts, but it was so calm and peaceful that it stopped me in my tracks. And right after this happened, for some reason, I felt like I should walk over to the bookshelf. So I walked over and I spot an old black book. Bear in mind, this bookshelf has hundreds of books on it. And I spot this old black book that I have not seen before. I pull it out and I realize it's a Bible. As I'm turning through the pages, I see there are verses underlined all throughout this Bible with dates written next to them. The dates are ranging from a couple years before I was born to a little while after. And I realize this is my mom's Bible, which means at one point my mom had faith. It was like God showed me that in that moment of desperation where I was feeling so fed up with my life, with my family, with not being able to understand why the relationship was like it was between me and my mom. I believe he showed me that because he knew how badly I needed a renewed sense of hope. And this is where the story gets really good. If you don't believe what I've told you so far, you will definitely not believe the rest. It was a few months after Christmas, the 12th of April, 2015, and my church was doing baptisms. They were having three services, two in the morning, one in the evening, and I was going to all three because I had not been baptized yet. I had a feeling I might be that day, but I was going to all three services because I wanted to kind of scope it out and see what it was like. I had never even been to a baptism service before. So in the early morning service, I was sat on one side of the church by the windows. I was watching people being baptized and I started to feel a strong draft around me. So I asked my friend who was sat next to me if she could please close the windows because I was feeling cold. And she looked at me and said, Cait, the windows are closed. And I was like, oh, don't you feel that really strong breeze that's coming through here? It's making me feel really cold. And she said, no, I don't feel it, which was odd. And I remember I was also wearing a really big puffy jacket, so it was strange that I was feeling so cold. And then I started to notice that the wind would start and stop. Every time someone got into the baptism pool, I felt the wind all around me. They would get out and the wind would stop. Then another person would get into the baptism pool. I felt the wind all around me. They got out and it would stop. I know this sounds insane, like I've lost my mind. And because of that, I have only ever told a handful of people that this happened to me. But it was so significant that I wrote about it in my journal, which I'm going to put a screenshot of if you're watching the video version on YouTube or Spotify. So if you want to see receipts, I have got receipts. I wrote, on Sunday the 12th of April 2015, all morning, every time someone got in the baptism pool, I felt a cold wind over my hands and face. I asked my friend if she could feel it, but she said no. I think I should mention here that I was a baby Christian at this point of my life. I did not know about spiritual things. The only other person I told at the time was the guy I was dating. Let's call him Sam. Sam said, "Wow, that's really cool. Did you know that the Holy Spirit is sometimes described as a wind?" And I remember just thinking, "Oh, that's interesting," but not really paying much mind to it until last year. Now I'm 26. I've matured as a Christian, and I'm starting to look into Hebrew words. For some reason, I looked up Spirit of God in the original Hebrew, and I found that it translates to Ruach. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but it means wind or breath of heaven. So that blew my mind. But then I also read Acts 2 last year, which describes when the Holy Spirit very first came to the disciples. It says, "A violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting." And finally, as if it can't get any crazier, I also opened up last year to a friend about the wind experience. And he had said that I should read a book called Good Morning, Holy Spirit by Benny Hinn. He said I would freak out when I read chapter 1. And I did. Because in this chapter, Benny Hinn recounts the exact same experience. I had obviously never heard of anyone else experiencing this before. But he talks about standing in a church, all of a sudden feeling a draft, checking the windows, not knowing where it was coming from, and feeling wind moving like a wave around him. When I read this, I started weeping. It felt like such confirmation that what I experienced that day was real, and God's Spirit was moving. I didn't fully understand all of that at the time, but I did take it as a sign that I was meant to get baptized, and so I put my name down for the evening service. After I did that, I had numerous people come up to me that morning and say they were so excited that I had put my name down, and people kept saying to me, "Make sure you invite your mom." Now, honestly, this was almost weirder than feeling wind all around me that no one else could feel. Because all of these people knew the situation with my mom. They knew that she didn't want me to go to church. They knew the relationship was strained. They knew I had been living at the pastor's house because things had been that bad. And so the fact that multiple people that day suggested that I invite her is still bizarre to me. I even remember just politely nodding, but thinking, why would I invite my mom? But I had to go back to her house that afternoon. So Sam came with me, and on the way there, I had said to him, "Please don't say anything about me getting baptized. I don't want my mom to know. I just don't want any drama today." But lo and behold, bless him, he was having a conversation with my mom, and he accidentally let it slip. My mom turned to look at me across the kitchen, and her eyes were full of tears. And she just said, "Were you not going to invite me?" And I said, "I didn't think you would want to go. You don't even want me to go to church." And she just said, "Of course I would want to go." So I was very confused, but I said, "Okay, you can come." I told her what time it was and where to meet us. She said she would meet us there. Now, I had been nervous the whole day leading up to this point anyway, because as a teenager, I was extremely socially anxious. I did not like having eyes on me, and I knew at the baptism I was going to have to stand in the pool in front of the whole congregation, take the microphone, and tell everyone why I was choosing to get baptized. I had been writing in my phone notes, practicing what I was going to say, but the fear I felt that day was almost crippling, which is sometimes one way you can know you are exactly where you're meant to be, because the enemy is going to hit you with fear to try and stop you from doing what God has called you to do. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." Anytime you are feeling intense fear, you have to stop and ask yourself, if fear is not from God, who are you taking it from? However, once I found out my mom was coming, the fear immediately flipped. Instead of worrying about what I was going to say, I was just now thinking, what is my mom going to say? What is she going to do? Is she going to confront the pastors? I just didn't know. I did not know what her headspace was like. I did not know where her mind was at. But we went to the church that night. Mom sat down with us. We started watching people being baptized. And then it was my turn to go up. I don't know how they do it at other churches, but at my church, they would invite your friends and family to come stand by the baptism pool while you're standing in it. And they would invite them to say something about your faith journey. So my friends walked up to the pool, Sam walked up, and my mum came up to stand by the pool. Sam took the microphone and said something, my friends did too, and then I saw my mum walking up to take the microphone. My stomach was in knots. I did not know what she was going to say. But she took the microphone and she said that a long time ago she had walked away from her faith because a lot of really painful things had happened in her life and she had been angry at God. But she said that after watching my journey, she felt like she was ready to come back to her faith. I remember looking out and seeing my pastors. They were sat directly opposite me. And their jaws were on the floor. My jaw was on the floor. Everyone was just so shocked and could not believe that this was happening. We were so happy. Everyone was hugging. And then I got baptized and I went to go and sit down with my mom. And after a while, I said to her, "You know, if you want to be baptized tonight, you can be too." And she sat there for a while thinking about it as we watched more and more people. And then towards the very end of the night, she said, "I think I want to be baptized too." So my mom and I got baptized on the same day, the 12th of April, 2015. It felt like such a fulfillment of what God had spoken to me a few months earlier. But I never could have imagined my mom coming to the Lord in that way. And if you think that's the cherry on the top, it's not. There is one last miracle to this story that happened last year, so 8 years since the baptism. We were looking for a new house for my mom to rent, and as we were driving up to this one house, there was a lady stood on her driveway blowing leaves. As we drove past, Mom said, I'm sure that that's Julie, who I used to work with 8 years ago. And I said, Mom, please don't call out to her in case it's not her. It had been so long since they had seen each other. So she didn't say anything. We went to look at the house. We came home. And Mom kept saying, I'm sure that was Julie. I'm sure it was. So she finds Julie's number. She hasn't spoken to her in years. They had kind of lost contact because my mom had changed jobs. But she finds her number. She calls her up, and it turns out it was Julie. Mom tells her that she's looking at a house that's next door, and she also says that she has since become a Christian and she's been baptized. And Julie says, oh, well, when you move in, you can come to my Bible study at my house. And I now go with my mom to that Bible study, which is unbelievable. The first time that we went, I sat there and I just thought, wow, God knew this all along. God knew 8 years ago when I was living with my pastors. Mom had basically kicked me out for going to church. I didn't know if I would ever have a good relationship with her again. My mom was working with Julie, but she did not want to know about God. And he knew that one day, 8 years later, I would be sat at a Bible study at Julie's house with my mom. He was working the entire time. And I felt so sad that I had ever doubted him. There were times that I was giving up hope. There were times that I was angry with God and frustrated because I felt like he didn't care about my situation or about my family. And he brought things so full circle in a way that only he could do. And so I really want to encourage you today, if you have an unsaved family member or friend that you are praying for, even if that situation looks hopeless right now, I need you to know it's not hopeless. Even if it seems like God is doing nothing, I understand, believe me, but he is doing something. He is putting people and things and opportunities in that person's path to try and reach them. He will not stop pursuing that person. And I know how much your heart longs for that person to know Jesus like you do, and to experience his love and his grace and his freedom. And God wants that person to be reconciled to him even more than you do. You are strategically placed in that person's life to show God's love to them. So please do not stop praying. I even joke with my mom now that she is like the modern day Saul to Paul conversion. If you don't know that story, I think it's in Acts chapter 9. Saul was someone who hated the church so much that he was persecuting and even killing Christians. Then he had an encounter with Jesus, and it radically transformed his whole life. God changed his name from Saul to Paul, and he went on to become one of the greatest apostles. He even wrote most of the New Testament, which we still read today. And that story serves as a reminder that there is no one that is too far gone that God can't reach them. Please know that if God did this in my life and in my family, he can do it in yours. If you have someone that you are specifically praying for, I would love to pray with you. You can leave me a comment or you can send me a DM on the 828 Women Instagram page. I am so excited to hear what God does in the lives of the people you love. Thank you all so much for listening to this episode. If you are enjoying this podcast, please do consider leaving a review. It really does help me be able to get this out to more people. And share this with anyone who you think may be encouraged by it. I appreciate you all so much. I hope you have a wonderful week ahead. Until next time, God bless you guys, and I will talk to you again next week.